you do this and you are going to be in the favor of the Lord, which is way cool. For to be favored by the Lord means to be the recipient of his demonstrated delight. Who doesn't want that? I know that I do. I want to live in the demonstrated delight of the Lord. So number one is humility. Now, humility comes from a Latin word, from the same word that means the earth. When I'm working in my garden, I'm on the ground. I go really low to pull those weeds and to plant those plants. When you are humble, truly a humble person, you are a person who automatically goes low. It's not contrived. It's not made up. Humility comes from the heart. If you don't understand the biblical definition for humility, these scriptures are going to help you. Isaiah 66 verse 2 says, "These are the ones I look on with favor." Now, this is the Lord himself speaking. Okay, so pay attention. Whenever I come to a place in the Bible where the Lord is speaking and he says, "This is how you will have favor with me," I read it and I read it and I read it, okay? So I'm going to say it again. "These are the ones I look on with favor," says the Lord. "Those who are humble and contrite in spirit and who tremble at my word." Again, favor means the demonstrated delight. So in this instance, we're talking about the demonstrated delight of the Lord. When the Lord pours out blessings on you, he's demonstrating his delight in you. When he's answering your prayers, oftentimes he's demonstrating his delight in you. When you are seeing miraculous things happen, signs and wonders, incredible provision in your life, that's the demonstrated delight of God, okay? When you feel his presence, when you feel his nearness in your personal prayer time, not necessarily corporate setting where he might come and move on the whole congregation, but when you're meeting with him face to face, as a man meets with a friend or a woman with a friend in your prayer time, and you experience the nearness of the Lord, he is showing you his demonstrated delight for you. Proverbs 3:34, "Toward the scorners, he is scornful, but to the humble, he gives," can you guess what that word is? "He gives favor." I'll read it again. Proverbs 3, verse 34, "Toward the scorners, he is scornful, but to the humble, he gives favor." To understand who God favors, we must also understand what a scorner is, because here in Proverbs is something that, I just put on my brakes and made me stop and really think about, have I been scornful? Ooh, I hope not. I live in the fear of the Lord, always with the awareness of the Lord being present with me. I'm sensitive to what he wants and to what he thinks and to what pleases him. And because I live that way, I refrain from saying things that would displease him about anyone, whether that individual is in the wrong or not, okay? So a scorner, that's something that I don't want to be, and I'm sure you don't want to be a scorner either. A scorner is someone who has open dislike and disrespect for someone or something, and or they mock or ridicule someone or something, okay? So a scorner, and of course, this is like we're talking about a person who does this habitually, not a one-time, oops, I didn't mean to say that, not a one-time oops, but a person who habitually, openly shows dislike or disrespect toward another person, whether that person is in the right or wrong. The Bible calls that individual a scorner, and a person who openly mocks or ridicules another person or something, that person is considered a scorner when they do it more than once in a long while. And according to the word of God, none of us want to be that person, even if the other person is unjust and even if the other person is a scoundrel. We want to live in a way that pleases the Lord. We want to be in a way where God's perpetual delight is demonstrated upon us and in our lives. Scripture makes it clear that being a scorner displeases the Lord. Scorners are not favored by God. Who is favored by the Lord? The humble, because the humble choose to stay low before him. They live aware of how God feels about people, about all people, including sinners, including scoundrels, including people who are just downright mean. These people understand that mocking and ridiculing and slandering anyone is a verbal assault against someone who God sent his son to die for, someone who God deeply loves and cares about. Scorners can't be favored because they break the law of love and they exhibit the nature of the fallen angels. The nature that the favorite of God exhibit is a nature that is close to and becoming like in perfection, coming progressively growing into the nature, the character, and the traits that Jesus Christ, Son of God, had and has. He, the King of Kings, washed the feet of the disciples. Those were dirty, stinky, smelly feet. And he washed them. He, the King of all glory, washed dirty, stinky, yucky feet. He demonstrated to us, all of his followers, how we are to be servants of all, servants of all. Oh, I just love him so much. You know, even when he, even when it looks like he ridiculed the Pharisees, you know, he was doing that as it was a teaching moment and it was shock therapy. When he called the Pharisees, "You bunch of whitewashed sepulcher with dead men's bones inside of you," he was saying, "You're clean on the outside. Boy, you should look nice on the outside, but what a mess you are inside. You look so white and pretty on the outside, but inside you're full of death." That's what he was saying to the Pharisees. And it was meant to shock them. That was shock therapy intended to zap them, to give them a jolt, to wake them up and to help them to repent and change their ways and stop being the hypocrites that they were being. And so that wasn't mockery from the Lord. Mockery is a sin. That wasn't mockery, okay? That was the Lord out of love trying to shake up these men. He's so good to us. Well, when we became Christians, all of us who believe and who are born again, we entered into a covenant with the Lord God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob. And in this covenant, there's an agreement that was ratified with the blood of Jesus Christ. Okay. Every covenant is formed with the shedding of blood. And it is through the blood of Jesus that this covenant was made. It's a wonderful covenant because it gives all of us the right to sonship and to an inheritance that is beyond anything that any of us can even imagine. And that is what the Father wants for us. And it's provision for today, now, in this life, on this earth, because we have very practical needs. And it's provision that exceeds what we have here in the life to come. Now, in that covenant, just like in all covenants, there's two parts. And the biggest part is that the Lord did it all. He did everything. He fulfilled all of the old covenant. He fulfilled all of the word of God, and all of the requirements of that covenant were fulfilled in him. We who believe in him entered into the ratified covenant through Jesus Christ. And in that ratified covenant, instead of having a bazillion laws and commandments that we are supposed to memorize and then try to follow, we have this one great commandment. It is called the law of love. When a person is a scorner, when they mock others and they ridicule others and they gossip and they slander and they dislike people, and out of their dislike, they're speaking all of this stuff or writing it on social media, they have broken the law of love. That's what the word of God says. So if you don't like that, take it up with Jesus. That's what what Jesus said. We are to live in a completely different way than the rest of the world. So to be close to God, to walk and live our lives in a way that is especially close to Him, to live in the favor of God, we need to really guard our hearts and not fall for the trickery of the adversary who wants us to be hooked by our feelings of outrage over injustices that are done in government and injustices in society. The enemy wants to hook us into falling into the trap of ridicule, mockery, slander, spreading gossip, whether it's true or false. He wants us to be emotionally involved and get all stirred up and outraged. But God, you know, He gave us peace. He gave us shalom. He gave us the mind of Christ. He wants all of us, His children, to live a completely different way so that those who are the scoundrels and those who are the crooks, and some of you know who they are by name, so that those people will have an opportunity to come to Him. Also, the Lord showed me quite a while ago that those who have entered into this mockery and this gossip and the slander, when they pray for the people that they have slandered, mocked, or ridiculed, their prayers are not heard by the Father. He will not hear their prayers for those individuals. Live humbly before your God. Don't be a scorner. The world is full of good folks who are caught up in the scorn trap. They're not in a good way with the Lord right now. He's not happy with it. And He wants the believers, the followers of Christ, to live as close to Him as possible and to live like Christ. Live humbly before your God. Go low, even when you are furious, even when you feel justified, even when you have the latest facts about someone. Go low, live humbly, and live in the demonstrated delight of the Lord.